Focus, folks. Thanks so much for joining me. I don't even have an intro for you guys here today. We got to talk about what Michael Burry just said. My opinion on all this, okay? He just tweeted out just moments ago. People always ask me what is going on in the markets. It is simple. Greatest speculation bubble of all time. All things by two orders of magnitude. Wow, okay, that is a big tweet there out of Michael Burry, okay? Now, if you don't know Michael Burry, you're like, who the heck is this guy? You never heard of him, okay? He's got very, very famous from a book and also a movie that was made around his bet that the housing market was going to crash, okay? And this was, you know, when he was placing that bet, that was, he was kind of like 2004, 2005. So he actually got in a little before you really should have. And then eventually the market did crash, right? The housing market did crash. That was really around like 2007 going into 2008, right? And he made it, his fund a ton of money at that time. If I recall, they were Scion Capital Management. And not just that, he got super famous for that bet on the housing market, because there's definitely, there was a lot of folks that back then believed like the housing market could never collapse or never crash or something like that, right? And he believed it was gonna happen, and he made, you know, this fund a lot of money, even though he got in maybe a little before they should have got in, okay? And Christian Bale, he played the character in The Big Short, got super, super famous from that, okay? Now, something very important for me to just mention here when it comes to Michael Burry, okay, is just because you got something right one time in a major way like that, right, does not mean you are now forever like a genius on all things, okay? That is something very important to understand, right? We don't look, you know, if you try to, you know, think about like somebody that's a stock picker, right? And somebody picks, you know, a successful stock. We don't automatically say, oh my gosh, they're the greatest genius ever because they got that one stock right, right? However, if somebody goes short the market or short something and they win big, we all of a sudden call that person a genius and we make, you know, documentaries about them and movies about them and things like that, right? I could be out here hitting home runs on stocks and getting 100% gain, and like doing, like hitting all these home runs, and you know, a lot of folks just don't care. But you make a right move, you know, betting against the housing market, all of a sudden you're hailed as a genius forever, okay? But we've seen it time and time again where a lot of short sellers never can emulate that type of success ever again, right? We've seen Jim Chanos and some of these other folks that, man, they had some huge thing that kind of made them super famous 20 years ago, and then they're trying to bet against this and that in the future, and they fall flat, and they fall flat, and they fall flat, and they lose money, and it's like, well, you know, it's been a long, long time since they really had a big home run or something like that. And so I just want to kind of always caution you guys about that, because you're going to hear of these super famous people that get famous from shorting something, and they make a ton of money, and then all of a sudden everybody, like, you know, hails them as like a god of the financial markets or something like that. And it's like, you know, you need to be, you know, nailing things out of the ballpark constantly, in my opinion, to be, you know, hailed as somebody that's truly great at this game, okay? Now, Michael Burry, big short investor, is back on Twitter and warning this is the biggest market bubble in history, okay? Michael Burry said the markets were in a bubble of unprecedented scale. The big short investor tweeted his dire warning after a 10-week break from Twitter. Burry has flagged reckless speculation on Tesla stock, Bitcoin, and other assets. Michael Burry on Tuesday warned that this is the biggest market bubble in history, okay, suggesting that his concerns are about rampant speculation grew during his 10-week hiatus from Twitter. People always ask me what's going on in the markets, the investor tweeted. It is simple. Greatest speculation bubble of all time in all things by two orders of magnitude. Hashtag flying pigs 360. The hashtag is likely a reference to the famous saying in investing, bulls make money, bears make money, and pigs get slaughtered. Burry has reportedly told investors that being too greedy, speculating wildly, you basically, you know, that's bad stuff. And everybody kind of knows that, right? You know, eventually that can end up catching up to you, right? And so he's obviously very, very clearly negative about Tesla, Bitcoin, and other assets in general, right? And so I kind of want to address all these. I want to talk about what it would take for, you know, a major market kind of meltdown. I want to talk about Tesla here. I want to talk about Bitcoin here, okay? So Tesla, let's talk about this one first, right? Stock is short. First off, a lot of smart people have lost a whole lot of money over the past decade betting against Tesla stock, right? I mean, I heard people shorting the stock all the way back to like 10 years ago, right? And every step along the way, you know, short sellers lost money. Tesla is just a tough company to bet against. It does not trade like a normal stock trades. And so if you want Tesla to trade the same way Ford and GM trades, it just doesn't work like that, man. It just doesn't work like that. Like people view Tesla as the face of electric vehicles, which everybody, you know, is starting to believe electric vehicles are the future now, right? A few years ago, you can make an argument, maybe that wasn't the case. I don't think there's anybody you can ask nowadays that doesn't believe EVs are the future, you know, are not the future, right? So if you're placing a bet against Tesla, you're placing a bet against EVs, right? The face of the EVs, right? Also autonomous driving, self-taxi networks, all those sorts of things, right? Energy sector in general, right? And the changing landscape there. So, you know, Tesla, it's a hard stock to bet against because anyway, along Tesla's, you know, creation, right? Every step along the way, you could have made a valid argument that Tesla was overvalued. Back in 2010, you could have said this, 2012, 2014, 2016, 2018, 2020, 2021. The thing is Tesla does not trade the others the way you want it to trade. These short sellers want Tesla to trade a certain kind of way. Now, I've always felt like Tesla could easily go down to like $400 or so, right? And that's definitely a possibility. But in terms of getting the stock, if Michael Burry or these other short sellers, you know, believe that all of a sudden Tesla's going to be valued at $50 billion or something like that, it's a really hard thing to see. Because as soon as this valuation starts dropping in any major way, you have all these investors on the sideline, right? And all these funds that are just waiting to buy Tesla. I mean, if Tesla was all of a sudden down 50% tomorrow, I pretty much think it's impossible because there would literally be so much money flooding in that stock from the retail investors alone, never mind big institutions that have wanted to build big positions in a company like Tesla, right? When you think about that for a moment, there's just so much money out there to go into this stock because they're in the forefront of EVs and autonomous driving, and they're changing the whole battery and solar landscape, right? And so that's a tough bet. We know so many famous short sellers that had success in other companies have just failed again and again and again short selling Tesla. I don't care what valuation Tesla goes to, I would never consider shorting that stock. A trillion, a 2 trillion, like it doesn't matter. It literally doesn't matter. I wouldn't consider shorting it because it does not trade like other stocks trade. And that's the bottom line. And all these short sellers want Tesla to trade the way other stocks trade. It doesn't do that. There are certain stocks in the stock market, they don't trade like the way you would think they would trade, okay? Netflix has always been one of those companies. Amazon's always been one of those companies. Tesla's always been one of those companies. You know, you might want it to be at the same valuation these other companies are, but it's not going to do that. That's not the way it works when it comes to that, okay? And so Michael Burry, when it comes to kind of Tesla, you know, woo, tough one there, okay? You know, supposedly spoken up about Bitcoin, things Bitcoin could crash, things like that, okay? First off, I think everybody in the Bitcoin community always acknowledges the fact that Bitcoin will crash, can crash, things like that, right? But, you know, to say Bitcoin's a bubble, here's a tough thing with that, right? It doesn't matter what price Bitcoin is, you could always say it's a bubble. It doesn't mean the price is going down. It doesn't mean the price is going to even, you know, consider going down, right? You could always make that argument around Bitcoin. Back when Bitcoin was a dollar, you could have made that. Oh, it's just some made-up currency. It's just some made-up thing. Who should pay anything for that? So you could have made that argument when Bitcoin was at a dollar, when it was at $10, $100, $1,000, $10,000, $100,000, $1 million, right? I'm talking about market cap, right? And all along the way, you could have made this argument. All along the way. And meanwhile, where is Bitcoin gone? The people want to own Bitcoin. That's just the bottom line with that. Once again, you can fight against these forces all you want, but they're tough fights to try to win, right? If people want to use Bitcoin as kind of like a cash reserve, that's their choice. Like you can't kind of get in the way of that. You can make a decision to not own that and you say, I don't want to put my cash in that, right? But at the end of the day, if people want to do it, they want to do it, right? I've never really seen a point in owning gold. I've never wanted to own gold, right? Like, what's the point of owning gold to me, right? It doesn't mean I don't believe gold is worth, you know, $10 trillion or whatever gold's market cap is, right? It doesn't mean I don't believe in that. It's just I don't want to participate in that market. I can't call gold a bubble because some people love to buy gold and hold gold, okay? Same thing with silver. Same thing with Bitcoin. Some folks love to hold that as kind of like a place to hold money. And I can't get in the way of that and say that's a bubble because it's priced at whatever. At the end of the day, it's what other people are willing to pay for that, okay? And so, you know, when you're talking about cryptocurrencies in general, like, you know, how can you say Bitcoin's worth $750 billion? How can you say Ethereum's worth $300 billion? Or Tether's worth $62 billion? Or Binance Coin is worth $56 billion? Or Cardano's worth $49 billion, right? You can go through all of these and be like, how is this worth this, right? And all of these crypto projects launch all the time that who knows what's going to happen with them, right? $1 billion market cap. It's like, what makes this coin worth $1 billion, right? You could always say that with all the cryptocurrencies. But at the end of the day, doesn't mean they're going down. It doesn't mean they're done for, something like that, right? Because there's always a lot of money that where, you know, people want to use these as places to hold capital. That's just the bottom line. So that covers crypto there, okay? Now, if we're talking about the markets in general, let's talk about the markets in general for a bit. So we know I've gone through valuations before, right? And valuations are definitely on the higher end, especially when it comes to larger cap companies, okay? And there's no doubt about that. I wouldn't necessarily call it a bubble, but we've definitely kind of been higher ranges. However, a lot of companies have been reporting some unbelievable earnings beats quarter after quarter after quarter, which obviously makes these companies even more profitable, right? And basically shows that these companies deserve to, you know, command higher valuations. How long that lasts for, we'll have to see as far as that goes, right? But I mean, if we look at the Dow, let's go back to 2007. 2007, the Dow was at 14,000 and some change, right? So, I mean, we're talking, all these years have gone by, it's 2021, and the Dow's barely over doubled in that amount of time, right? That's not good performance for the Dow, I can just tell you that, okay? 14 years have gone by, 14 years, okay? Literally 14 years have gone by, and the Dow Jones Industrial Average has a little over doubled. That's just not good, right? If the Dow had, you know, quadrupled or 5x or 6x in that amount of time, then I'd be like, oh shoot, man, things have gone crazy, right? Yeah, the market had an amazing 2020, but that was coming off of the fastest stock market crash we ever had, right? And then all of a sudden the stimulus money was pumped out there. It wasn't the end of the world. Companies made it through. Some companies are actually in much better capital positions now than they were prior to Roni Rona, which is crazy to actually think about, right? Because that huge sloshing of money, super cheap interest rates, being able to raise capital and things like that, right? So look at that. You know, where's the bubble in that? You know what I mean? Like, where's the bubble in that? We can go back even further. Look at this. Let's go back to the 90s. Yeah, the 90s, that's a little while ago, okay? 1999, the Dow was 11,000, okay? So the Dow has tripled in the last 22 years? Tripled in 22 years? Once again, that's not great performance, right? So there's always going to be certain things we can look at in the market that if we want to make a case that the market's in a bubble, overvalued, things like that, we can make that case, right? There's always, what I've learned in the market since I got in 2008, 2009, there's always certain things in the market where you can look at something and be like, we're in a bubble right now. We're overvalued. But then you can pull up other things and you could easily make a case and just destroy that other case, essentially, okay? And so that's kind of what I found over time. Every single year I've been in the market, you could have made the arguments that the market was overvalued, undervalued, based upon different metrics you're going to look at, right? Sometimes it's forward P's. Sometimes it's trailing 12-month P's, if you want to pull up that, right? Sometimes it's price to sales ratios. Sometimes it's, you know, return on equity. Sometimes it's just like, well, the market's gone up a lot in the past year. That's way up, you know, up way more than usual. There's always going to be some factors that you can look at to say that the market is overvalued or undervalued in a given time. That's just the way it works, okay? Now, let's talk for a moment on what it would truly take for a true stock market crash to come. This everything bubble, Michael Burry calls it. How do you get the everything bubble to burst? Because this is the question that so many people are asking. How do you get that question, or how do you get that thing to happen where all of a sudden stocks are crashing, real estate's crashing, Bitcoin's crashing, Ethereum's crashing, cryptos in general are crashing, and all assets are crashing, okay? I'll tell you exactly what you need to happen. Let's think first back at the last major, major recession we had, right? Obviously, you can call 2020 a recession, right? In a, you know, bad time period, but a lot of folks got through it because we pumped all that stimulus money out there, cheap interest rates, and we were coming off a very good economy. So a lot of folks don't just kind of throw out 2020, which means if you're going to throw that out, then let's go all the way back to 2007, 2008, 2009, right? What happened to essentially make everything crash, right? Real estate, stocks, all those things, right? If you think about that for a moment, the thing that really made things crash is how capital dried up, right? Capital dried up in the markets, right? And the next thing you know, it was hard to get access to capital to buy anything, whether it be a house, whether it be a car, whether it be, you know, business financing or things like that, right? And when all that capital dried up, right, then, and the bank system was at risk and everything like that, right? Then all of a sudden you had more and more companies starting to lay off, right? Because all of a sudden there was less money out there, right? Less business expansion, and companies went into a very turtle mentality, right? Like you know a turtle, when a turtle gets scared, it goes into its shell, right? And that's kind of where companies went. And a lot of companies had to do it. It wasn't like all companies were forced to do that. A lot of companies felt like they wanted to make that decision or had to make that decision, right? Because essentially, they were not having as big of opportunities as they thought they were going to have. And also, like, some of their businesses started losing money, right? So if you look out right now, right, I mean, you can't go anywhere without hiring signs everywhere, right? It doesn't matter if it's low-paying jobs, decent-paying jobs, high-paying jobs. It doesn't matter, man. Like, you want a job right now, like, it's cake. That's the bottom line, okay? It is cake to get a job right now in the market. You can, like, literally, I can't drive anywhere in Vegas or Arizona or anywhere without seeing hiring signs everywhere on just about any building you could possibly imagine out there, right? Plenty of jobs and actually not enough workers to fulfill those jobs at the moment, right? I mean, right now you have to wait like, I've had some people, you know, that had to take Ubers and things like that, saying they have to wait like 20 minutes just to get an Uber ride right now, right? That's crazy. You know, you should be like, you get an Uber ride in like 5 minutes. Now I'm talking about 20, 25 minutes just to finally get your dang Uber ride because there's just such a lack of drivers right now, right? Everybody's hiring and things like that, right? And so when you're in that sort of environment right now, How are you going to get a crash? How are you going to get stocks to crash? How are you going to get real estate to crash and all those things when there's plenty of money out there, when companies are flush with money, when companies are in expansion mode, when they're hiring, when there's plenty of jobs out there, right? You can't. If you ever get a situation where things flip and these companies that are hiring are no longer hiring, but also not only you're no longer hiring, but you're firing, you're letting folks go, different situation, very, very different situation. But in order to get that sort of situation, you need something to kind of like basically kind of shut down the banking system and make the big banks like really face some tough hardships. But the problem with that is, as soon as the banking system or anything feels any sort we might go under or you know, these banks are in trouble, what does the Fed step in and do? The Fed steps in and does whatever it needs to do, right? The Fed steps in and does whatever it needs to do to basically make sure those banks survive and the capital keeps flowing out there in the market, right? I mean, you know, with the whole Roni Rona situation, it was like, you know, snap a finger, shut down the economy. Next thing you know, companies were scared. What did the Fed do? They did everything, right? They call it the helicopter money, man. They did whatever it took to get the markets back flush with capital, right? So the markets could get back going again. Next thing you know, stocks started coming back, you know, real estate kind of balanced out, right? Companies, you know, didn't really have to do layoffs the way, you know, folks thought they were going to have to do, right? Because the Fed stepped in. And there was actually a time period, I remember just thinking about this now, there was time periods where it was actually you couldn't even, lay off employees or fire employees or things like that, right? And companies were, you know, the Fed was stepping in, government was stepping in, here's money, and just flooded out that money. And think about, remember when we were looking at the stock market chart, right? Think about the value of the dollar since 1999, right? When the Dow was at 11,000 or something in 99, right? Think about what's happened to the value of the dollar. The value of the dollar in that amount of time has gone poof. And think about 2007, right? When we were looking at the Dow was at 14,000 plus. What has happened to the value of the dollar since 2007? Do you get more or less in 2021 for your dollar than you did in 2007, right? Obviously, you get dramatically less nowadays, right? I mean, it's like night and day, right? And meanwhile, the stock market like hasn't had some crazy performance or something like that. So at the end of the day, we can talk about this is going to happen, that's going to happen. Stock market crashes come. Cryptocurrency crashes come, right? Real estate crashes, they don't come very often, but every once in a while they'll come. And then most of the time, it'll be like kind of a balancing out, right? These things are going to happen from time to time. But honestly, it is entertaining to listen to all this, but at the end of the day, if you're placing bets, it's a hard bet to win, right? It's a hard, hard bet to win. Doesn't mean it's impossible, but it's dang hard. Meanwhile, you look out there and you see, you know, undervalued stock here, huge opportunity here in this next, you know, multi-billion dollar industry, and it's like, Where could I spend my time? Worrying about the next crash, the next dramatic thing, or taking advantage of this next, you know, 2x stock or 3x stock in the market? That's what I'm always looking for. I'm looking for that next stock opportunity to get me to that level, regardless if there's a crash or anything. And a crash, cool. I'll be able to buy shares for cheaper. You know what I mean? So, you know, that's the kind of thing with Michael Burry here, and that's kind of my perspective on it. Prices have got pushed up for a lot, but man, you can always make arguments the other way on why certain things deserve to go up, why certain things are not as overvalued and those sorts of things, guys. So yeah, I would love to hear your opinion in that comment section. As always, hope you guys enjoy this. All I ask in return is that you smash that like button for this video. That helps out huge in the YouTube algorithm. If you want to check out the private stock group, go ahead and click the first link in the description down there. If you want to know where I get 75% plus of my stock picks, check out the second pinned comment down there. Much love as always, guys, and have a great day. We'll